Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, on every Sunday of the Paschal Tide, the Church is trying to get into the heart of the mystery of the resurrection of the Lord. On this third Sunday of Easter, as first reading, we hear from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 5, verses 27b to 32 and 40b to 41, that the disciples bear witness boldly to the resurrection of the Lord before the Sanhedrin is the theme of the reading. On account of that, the disciples had to suffer. But it's reported that the disciples were glad that they could suffer for the sake of the name of the Lord. The second reading is from the book of Revelation, chapter 5, verses 11 to 14. A choir of thousands of people sing of the achievements of Jesus. They sing, "The Lamb that was sacrificed is worthy to be given power, riches, wisdom, strength, honor, glory, and blessing. This is known as the redemption hymn, for it sings of the redemption accomplished by Jesus." It says that the Paschal mystery, the passion, death, and resurrection of the Lord has caused the salvation of all people, whether they come to know or acknowledge it or not. The Gospel passage, John chapter 21, verses 1 to 19, presents the risen Lord appearing for the third time to the disciples according to the fourth Gospel. He appears to them at the banks of the Lake of Tiberias. The disciples were in their fishing boat. They see Jesus, but they do not recognize him. They are silent. Jesus speaks and acts. They act on the directive of Jesus. When they act as directed by Jesus, they get a good and unexpected catch. Then Jesus eats with them the breakfast. Jesus then appoints Peter as a shepherd. This could be the summary of the story narrated here. Now the details. Upon the suggestion of Simon Peter, seven of the disciples go fishing. But that night, they got nothing. When it was getting morning, they had lost the hope of getting anything. The situation is quite dim and desperate. It was at the moment of their failure that Jesus appeared to them at the bank of the lake. He asked them, "Children, have you any fish?" It was in the farewell discourse that Jesus had addressed them as children, paideia. This is chapter 13, verses 33. It was a very affectionate address. At that time, they were upset as Jesus had told them that he was going away. He was taking leave of them. Now the risen Lord does not get away from them. He is with them in a very loving way, although in a different manner. As Jesus inquired, the disciples informed him of their fruitlessness in their work of the previous night. Then Jesus gives them an order, and they have an unprecedented and miraculous catch. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved recognized him as the Lord and declared it. This experience taught the disciples that their success is not dependent on their merit, talent, or capacity, but on his word. It's the beloved disciple who recognized the Lord. He is a symbol of faith. Once having known that it's Jesus standing at the shore, Peter could not anymore hold on. He jumps into the water. He forgets for a moment the boat, the fishing net, the great catch they had just then, his friends, and so on. He wants to reach Jesus before anyone else. He wants to be the first in reaching Jesus. Later in this scene, Jesus will ask Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" This is chapter 21, verse 15. Jesus invites all the disciples to come and eat breakfast. In chapter 6 of John, Jesus had multiplied bread and fish for a multitude of people over 5,000 at the banks of Lake Tiberias itself. Here Jesus does a different thing at the shore of Tiberias. He had prepared bread and charcoal fire with fish cooking on it. They are asked to bring some from the fish they had caught just then. Every Sunday, we bring together the fruits of our labor and sacrifice, which we have collected during the week, to unite them with the sacrifice of the Lord, to offer them as a sacrifice acceptable to the Father. Now Jesus gives them breakfast. In the 6th chapter of John, Jesus had called himself the bread of life. Now, after the resurrection, he continues to be the bread which nourishes both body and soul. Communion with him brings abundance of life. The disciples utter not a single word. They understand that this is the Lord. They acknowledge that the success of their life and work depends on the word of the Lord. The communion with him is indispensable if they should succeed in life. This is a fact that every disciple, every Christian should recognize. We cannot have success without him, without his word. Now, after the breakfast, Jesus turns to Peter. Their last conversation was during the farewell speech of Jesus. That was in John chapter 13, verses 36 to 38. At that time, Peter had said that he was ready to give up his life for Jesus. But Jesus had prophesied that Peter would go back in his word 3 times at the occasion of Jesus' passion. And that took place as well. Now Jesus asks Peter 3 times whether he loves him. And then he entrusts his flock to Peter 3 times to feed him. In fact, Jesus himself is a good shepherd. John chapter 10 verses 1 to 18. As the good shepherd, Jesus has great concern for his sheep. From now on, Jesus will not be physically present with the sheep. Therefore, as a vicar representative, he gives to Peter the work of shepherding. Peter has to guide the sheep in the new situation. Jesus himself remains his life and the way. It's only in communion with Jesus that life is maintained. The work of Peter is to guide the sheep to Jesus and hold them in communion with Jesus. Then the sheep will experience an abundance of life. Peter, in his conversation with Jesus, does not give a bold answer to the question of Jesus as to whether he loved him or not. Peter is rather diffident and is quite reserved and humble in his answer. The lessons of the past have taught him prudence and humility. Peter tells very humbly that he loves him. At the question asked for the 3rd time, Jesus replies and says, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Peter was indeed sad and upset that the Lord had asked him even a 3rd time. In fact, Jesus knew the whole story of Peter. Jesus knows the story of each one of us. In the farewell talk, Jesus had told Peter, "You cannot follow me now, but you shall follow me afterward." This is John chapter 13, verse 36. Now Jesus tells Peter, "Follow me." 21:19. Peter will require to follow him, but go through the path of suffering. Jesus will metaphorically inform him of the painful way in which Peter will require to follow him in this very passage. Peter cannot but take a path of suffering. Indeed, the command given to Peter, "Follow me," is one which is given to every disciple, every Christian. In the farewell discourse, Jesus had instructed his disciples as to how they should behave in his absence. In a way, Jesus repeats that now, as the risen one, they should recognize the risen one as the Lord and God and remain in communion with him. In that case, they will succeed in life. But the way that they should walk in union with him and after him is going to be difficult, once spotted with suffering. But he will strengthen them, giving them breakfast. Amen.